Well, again, I promise to be short. I know that you're exhausted by this very, very intensive week. The Glass Research in Brazil in the Center for Research, Technology, and Education. I'll give a very brief overview on the Glass Research in Brazil because I have already talked about this topic. Then the aims, the team, and some examples of technology, education, and outreach that we are carrying out at the moment. Finally, the goals and challenges of our CEPID that we call CeRTEV, Center for Research, Technology, and Education. Well, I told you before, but I'm not sure if Professor Osvaldo knows that the very first paper in Brazil in the glass area was published by Aldo Krajewicz, my supervisor of my master's thesis, and that's only 40 years ago, which agree with your observation that Brazilian science is extremely young. I heard once that the first master's thesis defended in all areas in Brazil was in 1965 in the Institute of ITA, Technological Aeronautics, in 1965. So everything is young in this area. And this is the share of glass-related papers authored by at least one researcher affiliated to a Brazilian institution. So I'm not talking about Brazilians, but researchers affiliated to Brazilian institutions. So it started in 1975. It fluctuated about one or two papers a year only. And then it started to take off in 1982 and so on. You know. And now there are signs of saturation. There are signs of saturation. And my most pessimistic co-authors even think that there are signs of decline. It all depends on how you analyze this curve. But that's the sort of argument that we use to convince FAPESP that they have to, you know, support this area. But the numbers are about 100, 100 and a few papers per year in this particular area. Okay, so we decided 2 years ago, 3 years ago, we decided to, you know, submit the proposal. Four? No, it was 1 year. 1 year working the proposal in 2 years that since we started. But anyway, from 3 to 4 years ago, we decided to join the forces of the researchers working in the Federal University in São Carlos and the University of São Paulo, this university. So we had seven people from the Federal University of São Carlos, seven from the USP. Later on, one migrated from the Federal University to UNESP Araraquara, which is only 35, 40 kilometers. So now we have three universities. People somehow working on vitreous materials, 14 faculty. So we have then 14 faculty from three universities, more or less 30 active collaborators, and we qualify active collaborators. Although there are more, but the active ones are those which have published with any of these guys in the last 2 or 3 years. So they're active. But the network is larger, of course. And we have about 50 MSc, PhD, and postdocs. This is the overall number that our group has. So this is one of the smallest. It's likely the smallest of all the CEPIDs. But we want it to be this way. We learned from the experience of Elson Longo and Bagnato and other people who had extremely large groups before that it's so complicated to organize their meetings, their internal meetings, that we decided to be small for a CeRTEV, for a CEPID. But mind you, in this particular area, we have a very strong advisory board. I'm going to list them all in a minute. But if this group Believe this or not, it's one of the largest academic class groups working in the planet. There are not more than five in the world of that size in this particular area. This is our international advisory board. People here, and the students here, I'm sure you know at least 90% of these names, including some of your supervisors are here. We have people here from Dr. Glebov's group. Where's Fedor? There is Leon Glebov. You know, these six persons here, they're well known, but they work for companies. They are highly ranked in some companies. You know, at least the CTOs of the companies, the research heads of some companies are here, because in the CEPID format, we have to do technology. So it's basic science, technology, and education. So we made this effort to invite these people from industry. And then we have university people. They are all extremely well known. We have a student here from Professor Jane. Yes, send my regards to Rimanshu. We also have it from Professor Komatsu. Ah, he disappeared. So I have to send a message to Professor Komatsu. From Professor Mesadek. Yes, send my regards to Eunice. And then we have some people who are know very well, Professor Fokin, where the our Russian colleagues. Yes. And then from Aldo Boccaccini, Elena. My regards to Aldo. Anyway, from Professor Russell, we have four students here from Jena. Yes. Yes. Very good. Four students. And there are four here. So I send a message to Professor Russell. There are all four here. Not only this, Professor Osvaldo. We covered the expenses of one because it was so competitive. And Professor Russell agreed to cover the other three. So, very good. Anyway, this is a very strong, believe me, these guys are really well known. And I made an experimental test. I'm a scientist, so last year I made a test. And the test was very simple. We had a board meeting in São Carlos, our second board meeting. By the way, we had three already, but the second, past year was here. So I made this test. I invited them all and said, well, you're truly invited to come, but we are not covering your air tickets. We are covering your staying in São Carlos if you come. From 21 members, 18 came. So that's an experimental proof that they're really interested in our group. They are really interested in giving their advice, in collaborating with us. And that was my test. And even to our surprise, some of our people say, oh, only half a dozen will show up. We had 18 of these guys here. It was a really good group meeting. Well, the CeRTEV is composed of our group in the Vitreous Materials Laboratory, the Department of Materials Engineering, the Department of Physics, this Institute of Physics, and the engineering school here, and now we have one member at the Chemistry Institute in Araraquara. The expertise, and that's how this is important to you. I think you had the opportunity during this whole week, all these members, except for Professor Mastelaro. He had some other commitments in this week, so he did not participate. But all the 14 minus one, these 13 professors participated actively in this school. There were tutors. You know, each group of students were assigned a tutor, and they are going to present a research proposal tomorrow morning, and you had a tutor, and these guys, you know, were really involved. Professor Eckert, you now know, you have seen his lecture also, NMR expert, Professor Schneider, an NMR expert, Professors Magon and Donoso, EPR experts. Professor Valmore is not here, but he is an XFs person. There are very few XFs persons in this country, which can be very useful for structural characterization of disorganized materials. And then you met Professor Pisani through his lecture on Raman spectroscopy, Professor Rino, molecular dynamics, then myself, Professor Andretta, laser crystallization, crystal growth, Professor Ana Rodriguez, electrical properties, Oscar Paitio just gave a lecture this morning on bioactive glasses and glass ceramics, and Professor Eduardo Ferreira on nucleation growth crystallization. And finally, Professor Andrea de Camargo and Professor Nalin, our optical properties experts. So if you look at this group, there are very few in the world with such a broad range of expertise, which comprise both scientific fundamental aspects, but also some technology development. Anyway, we have some goals. I do not have the complete list here, but some list which could be interesting for you. Conduct high-level research work on relevant subjects that push the frontiers of knowledge. This is fundamental science. Develop or improve glasses and glass ceramics in joint processes with industry. This is our technology part. Train highly qualified engineers, physicists, chemists, and researchers. Attract young people to the field of glass. Render relevant service to schools, research institutions, companies, and the society. And increase the number and quality of the Brazilian glass research and its influence at international level. So the idea is to boost our international network. And this is one of the aims of this school in particular, because we'll be not only linking with you as future leaders in glass science and technology, but also with your supervisors. And as I told you a few times, but I'm going to repeat this to Professor Osvaldo, because they're sponsoring us. They have been highly selected. We checked even their research groups and their supervisors in the selection process. So we picked some that are excellent students, but from some groups that we are interested, potentially interested in collaborating with. So their groups have been analyzed for the selection process. Well, this is the agenda of our CeRTEV. I mean, we will focus on multidisciplinary, relevant glass science technology and try to do efficient education and outreach. You now know that I am the director. Professor Hellmut Eckert is the vice director. Professor Eduardo Ferreira is our technology. He is an engineer, so he is our technology coordinator. And Professor Ana Rodriguez, the education and outreach coordinator. We have managers for all these areas also. The basic science that we focus on is relationships between molecular structure, dynamic processes, the diffusion, viscous flow, relaxation, and crystallization processes, and then their linkages to properties. And talking about properties, we come to the technology part. We are interested on mechanical properties, on biochemical properties for bioactive materials, on ionic conducting materials, for instance, for solid-state batteries, optical properties for lasers, for gratings, and catalytic converters, chemical properties. So these are five types of properties. We are stronger in some of these areas than in others, but we span all this range of properties. So this is an overall picture of the CeRTEV. When we started, the American Ceramic Society Bulletin had I gave an interview because they were so interested in this thing. They mentioned to me that this is probably the largest endeavor in the world at the moment in the glass research area. And although the funding is 5 plus 6, you know, we are assuming that we are going to do well and have 6 more years of funding, which then will be 11 years. So you have to write a long report in 3 years and, you know, try to extend this for 6 years, which it will happen in my opinion anyway. But the main thing here then is continuous funding. Continuous funding, that's the idea of these CEPEDs. I was working for FAPESP when we created these centers many years ago, and the idea was continuous funding, because people struggle. You start a research proposal, a nice project, and in 2 years you run out of funding. And you still have many things to do. You know, some types of research takes 5, 6, 10 years. So the FAPESP director at those days, Professor Paris, had this idea of mimicking some existing project in the National Science Foundation in the USA and continuous funding. So we are sure that at least for 5 years we have. And then if we manage to renew this contract, we have for other 6 years. But from the previous experience, all of the research centers, the CEPEDs, which started before us, were renewed for 6 more years. So chances are that, you know, we are going to have our project renewed. Continuous funding. So if you come as a postdoc, for instance, here, I'm not sure if Professor Osvaldo mentioned this, but I like to emphasize that it's 2 plus 2 years, right? You can have, initially, if you're approved, you have a grant for 2 years, and then you have to write a nice report and convince FAPESP that you're doing okay, they'll extend for 4 years. And that's the maximum, I think. 4 years is the maximum. But it's a good time for you to find a permanent job. You know, that's the maximum you can have. Also, there is some limitation. I think to apply for a postdoctoral fellowship, there is a time limit after the defense of the PhD.
6 or 7 years.
6 or 7 years. So an old guy like me cannot apply for a postdoctoral fellowship, right? But, you know, I'm thinking about that. You know, I'm thinking of retiring and get one of these, you know, young investigators award, so I do not qualify, too bad. But you will qualify, you know. Okay, I'll give you some very few examples of technological development, because Professor Eckert is going to dwell more on some scientific aspects of our center. Well, I like to repeat that figure. You know, this is the most well-known figure in the glass field. And I'm sure you have seen this figure before, Osvaldo, that you have some property here. It could be the enthalpy, or it could be the volume. You have a liquid above the melting point. You have a true liquid. And if you cool that liquid slowly enough, most liquids will crystallize. But in some situations, you can fool Mother Nature and avoid crystallization. And then you enter in this state of a super cool liquid. And at some low enough temperature, the structure cannot rearrange in the time scale of the experiment, so it's frozen in a glass. So a glass is just a liquid with all the properties of a liquid, but that could not relax during the time of the experiment. So then we have a glass, it's a frozen liquid. And then, if you want to make a glass, one has to avoid crystallization and come through this way, and there are techniques and tricks to do this. And then, but there's another path which can be followed. You can always heat a glass above TG and let it relax to the crystalline state, or you can even do so below TG. It takes longer, but you can do so. Relax the glass to the liquid and the liquid to the crystal, and then we form what's known as glass ceramics. I'm taking a little bit to explain to Professor Osvaldo. I know you're now experts on glass ceramic formation, crystallization, but just so he knows a little bit more what we have been doing. So, and the key in these things is to control the nano or microstructure. When you crystallize an undercooled liquid, a number of different crystal phases with different shapes and formats can form. In this case, we are trying to align. You see, these are the crystals, and the gray continuous areas are the glass phase. We're trying to align these phosphate crystals in some direction, because you know that bone, natural bone, is highly anisotropic, highly anisotropic. So it'd be nice to make some anisotropic artificial bones. That's the idea, you know. And one can vary the size, the number per unit volume, the volume fraction crystallized, the orientation, the chemical nature, and that's the sort of games that we normally play. You know, which kind of phases, how many crystal phases, how, what the sort of size distribution you're going to make to control the properties. All the properties depend on the so-called nano or microstructure, depending on the size of these crystals. This, by the way, was done by Marina and Murilo, our previous speakers here. Marina and Murilo got this unique microstructure with aligned crystals. This is called a glass ceramic. And there are all sorts of microstructures that can be obtained. And of course, this, by the way, is from Professor Komatsu's group. He induces crystallization by a laser heating. So he can form single crystals in a glass matrix, doing all sorts of designs or optical circuits and things like that with a laser. And the properties depend on all these parameters. Of course, these microstructures, each one of them belongs to a given system. A different system. This is a particularly interesting one. This is a pore. This is a pore. And you see there are more crystals. It's hard to see because the magnification is small, but the surface of the pore is covered by a layer of crystals. So nucleation rate is higher on this interface than in the volume of the glass. This is called heterogeneous nucleation and so on. Well, all these microstructures lead to very useful materials, glass ceramics. They're called glass ceramics. In Portuguese, it's vitro ceramicus. And they are used like in cooktop plates, but they can be used like in night vision systems. And there are people here. Is Andrew here? Yes, you're leaving, huh? Andrew is working these chalcogenide systems. You can produce materials which transmit in the infrared. So this is very, very high-end cars with a night vision TV here. So look at here. In the outside, you cannot see anything, but in the night vision camera, you see two people either walking or biking here. So these cameras are becoming standard parts in high-end cars. And there are machinable systems. Like mica, you can produce machinable glass ceramics, you can produce bioactive glass ceramics, even architectural, very nice architectural, artificial marble and granite and things like that. And even the lamp of this projector is made of glass ceramics. Well, just to give three examples, I spoke for about 25 minutes, so this is your boss. Leon Glebov. Leon developed, he perfected the so-called PTR glass, photothermal refractive glasses, were actually invented by Stuckey, who is the same inventor of glass ceramics, many years ago. And this is a nice, recipe. This is a recipe written by Joe Pearson. Joe Pearson is retired now, but it's a person working for Corning Glass. This is a plate of glass with crystals. He wrote, these are crystals that crystallize the area. He wrote a recipe to produce a photothermal refractive glass in a plate of glass. So you shine, you make some kind of mask, shine UV light, and then heat treat the sample. Only the areas which had been exposed to UV light crystallize. Now, if you make these crystals fine enough, much smaller than the wavelength of visible light, you can make a transparent material. And that's the idea of PTR glass, and you can make all sorts of gratings for high power lasers and things like that. And we have been working for many years with Leon Glebov, for more than maybe 8-9 years now, helping his team, his company actually, to improve the quality of these materials to minimize light scattering, things like that, through controlled crystallization. Another interesting thing is to produce transparent glass ceramics. You see, this is a glass, and this is a glass ceramic with 97% crystal phase, and about 3% of residual glass phase, and still transparent. So the idea, for instance, is to dope these materials with rare earths to get much a higher efficiency of luminescence, for instance. This is one of the research areas of Professor Andrea and Marcelo Nalin. And they can also be used for armor purposes, you know, ballistic resistant materials, because when you crystallize normally, they are much harder than the parent glass. So if you can still keep transparency, they can be used for armor materials. And this is one example. See the hardness of a glass, and the hardness, this is the maximum we got so far, from about 6.3 gigapascal to about 10. Oh, it's giga here, not mega. It's gigapascal, okay? Same scale. So to about 10 gigapascal. So these materials, now we are working. They're transparent, but it's still too dark because the nucleating agent is titanium. And titanium brings color. Now we have to find strategies to fade this color by adding some elements and things we are doing with Shiv and Atyar, you know, to fade the dark color of these materials. And I'm almost finishing dental glass ceramics. This is a very interesting area. And I found out that even here in São Carlos, there are a few dentists already using these artificial teeth or prostheses made of a glass ceramic. And they have a number of interesting properties. They have to be exactly equal to a natural tooth. They are fluorescent like a natural tooth. They're chemically durable in the mouth. And they must have very high strength. This is a measure of the intrinsic strength of a material. K1C is a measure of the intrinsic strength. And believe me, 3.5 is very, very high for a glass ceramic. A typical glass has a K1C of 0.5 to 0.7 in these crazy unities here. And a glass ceramic with 3.5 is like eight times stronger than a glass. And these materials can be used for artificial teeth. The word Eckert now is by a company in Liechtenstein, Evoclar. Their glass ceramics have a toughness of 2.7. Ours is much higher, but there is still some testing that we have to do. I mean, these are not on the market yet, but this is highly promising. And finally, you know, a number of bioactive glasses and glass ceramics you have seen in the previous talk. So to finish my talk, I like to say that we are open for visiting professors and international postdocs, and you have seen that there are opportunities via FAPESP, also via other funding agencies. Federal funding agencies also fund visiting professors and students, not students, but postdocs. So in the future, well, the future we are going to discuss tomorrow morning to see if you came up with really, really nice ideas of these research proposals that we can eventually really use the research proposals that you're going to propose tomorrow morning. So I look forward to seeing your talks tomorrow morning. Thank you so much for your attention. Hellmut.
Yeah, thank you again, Edgar, for setting the stage, introducing into the structure of CeRTEV, its technological achievements, and its educational mission. Already you reflected on some of the fundamental research that is going on, and I just want to present a few highlights and foci. Notice that research effort is divided into five areas, roughly reflecting important applications of glass ceramics in very diverse fields. But as it turns out, the questions, the scientific questions, are often very much alike, have a lot of relation to each other. And we're trying to benefit from the synergy of findings in these different areas. So findings from one area could teach us something about another area. So the goal, of course, is to develop a coherent research agenda that unifies the efforts of 14 people. So it's not like isolated efforts, this person does this, this person does that, but actually the goal is to work together on common themes then eventually arrive at new formulations for glasses and glass ceramics for the different applications. And one particularly important aspect, of course, is also to develop new experimental approaches to learn about structure, to learn about structure-function relationships, guiding us to make better materials. So some of the fundamental issues that the work that are common to all these areas of research is medium range ordering glasses, mixed network former effects, mixed cation effects, mixed anion effects, intermediate oxide effects. Edgar mentioned the PTR glass. The PTR glass contains, if I keep counting right, about 12 different chemical constituents, an extremely complex material. And if one of them is missing, it's not working. And the compositions have to be adjusted. It's a multi-parameter process. We don't know whether the PTR glass developed by Glebov is really the best one. Maybe one can even improve on that. But that takes a lot of work to analyze and understand both the conditions, effect of chemical composition and the conditions of processing and treatment on the properties and the performance. And so an important part is to actually address some really fundamental issues that Edgar, relating to crystallization and the transformation of glasses near and above the glass transition into crystals and ceramics. Dynamics and transports, like the breakdown of the Stokes-Einstein equation near the glass transition temperature, and how to describe viscosity in this region correctly. The effect of dynamic heterogeneity, the mechanisms of nucleation, the failure, the apparent failure of the nucleation theory to give the right order of magnitude of the nucleation rates, although the dependence on parameters seems to be okay. And of course, then, crystallinity and morphology need to be better controlled. Not, it's not a trial and error effort, but the goal is to achieve this control based on theoretical predictions. Now, theory actually enters in our research in from various different aspects, various different ends. One of them is molecular dynamics simulations, and that is an effort newly started within the CeRTEV by Professor Rino, looking at our drosophila lithium disilicate. This is an example, actually. Lithium disilicate is a material very simple in composition and extremely important in not only one area, but at least three of the areas that we are working on. So this is a good starting point. And here are some preliminary results that were recently published, funded by CeRTEV, looking at the dynamic heterogeneities in lithium disilicates. There are regions of lithium where the lithium is highly mobile. There are other regions where they cluster and have less mobility. And this all can be analyzed and predicted by molecular dynamic simulation. In this case, it is there were specific predictions on the validity of the Stokes-Einstein relation down to 1600 Kelvin. It'll be a challenge to investigate this experimentally, but it could be done with a suitable NMR method working at very high temperatures. This we cannot do here. We don't have the equipment, but we have collaborators that have agreed to work with us. So some of the results of Rino's work, if you have questions on this, he is here. He can answer more specifically than I would be able to do. But he can predict the diffusion coefficients of silicon, oxygen, and lithium in an excellent fashion in this material. There's ongoing work on another interesting material that also is known to undergo homogeneous crystallization, namely the barium disilicate melt. And there you have to actually start from, take a step back and actually first come up with a good potential on the basis of which you then do the simulation. So his work has developed two body potential for this glass, particularly for the barium. That's a challenge. And you can see the vibrational density of states matches pretty well already predicted and experimental. And here the neutron structure factor compared to experimental data, already very good agreement. So this looks very promising. We hope to have updates on this very soon. As I think has been mentioned numerous times and came across particularly in Edgar's class that he gave earlier this week, the way you transform a glass into a ceramic requires control, and once more control. It is influenced by many, many parameters which you need to evaluate their influence upon the rate and the size of the nucleation, the size of the crystal, the induction times, many parameters. And so there's a lot of simulation that needs to be done based on classical nucleation theory that is part of the ongoing theoretical efforts of Eduardo Bellini Ferreira and Edgar Zanotto to predict time temperature transformation diagrams. And then, of course, the comparison with experiments. And we are trying to develop NMR approaches to compare nucleation rates and morphologies of samples with NMR methods and the predictions over here. Simulation of differential scanning calorimetry data is another thing that another focus of Eduardo Bellini's work. And here, these are simulated DSC curves showing the crystallization peak for various different shapes of a diopside glass. You see that the DSC curves, depending on what the crystals look like, that the crystallizing material looks like differ. Right now, the experimental data is this, so we still quite haven't found, maybe Eduardo has an update soon on this. We take home from this work, though, that, we take home from this work, though, that in principle, the morphology can be judged from the DSC experiments. Another fundamental issue of glass crystallization is the prediction of why and when, under which conditions, glasses crystallize homogeneously, that is in the volume, as opposed to heterogeneous crystallization that would come from the surface. Surface crystallization is thermodynamically favored, but yet a handful of glasses, very important model glasses, and lithium disilicate belongs to them, but also soda lime glass and barium disilicate, they crystallize homogeneously. And we have recently completed a comprehensive review to understand what these glasses have in common that have this feature of homogeneous nucleation. Because in principle, that's an important thing to achieve. Homogeneous nucleation creates better ceramics because the distribution of the crystals is more uniform. You can control the whole process better than crystallization over, from the surface. And one thing these glasses have in common is that the reduced configurational entropy of homogeneously nucleating glasses is lower than that of the glasses that crystallize heterogeneously. And that suggests that the structure of the glass that crystallizes homogeneously is more similar to the crystal than in the case of the heterogeneously nucleating systems. Yeah? In other words, if the glass already has a structure close to that of the crystal it forms upon crystallization, we have good chances of achieving the thermodynamically disfavored homogeneous nucleation. And this needs to be explored, of course, on the basis of structural probes. So we are back to the question of glass structure. How do we define and how do we de-analyze glass structure? Of course, there's the local order, there's intermediate range order, there's medium range order at different length scales. And we have looked at a number of different parameters defining glass structure and come up with a finding that is quite interesting. It is the alkali cations, the network modifiers that need to be structurally similar in their environments to the glass, between glass and crystal, that seem to control the probability of homogeneous nucleation. And we used a number of structural parameters. The work of Valmore Mastellaro must be mentioned here. He did EXAFs, show that the alkali ion environments in homogeneously nucleating glasses are closer to those of the crystals they form. And with NMR spectroscopy, one can come to a similar conclusion regarding the spatial distribution of the alkali ions based on these dipolar second moment measurements that I had told you about in my class. You can see here that for the homogeneously nucleating glasses, lithium borate and lithium disilicate, these are different measurements. The second moments, the differences in the structures according to the NMR measurements seem to be smaller than for the heterogeneously nucleating examples, sodium borate, sodium disilicate, and a the albite glass. So that work is still ongoing, but an important take-home message really is the modifier seems to run the show, not the network former. Yeah, the technological development on bioactive glasses has been mentioned by Edgar. And of course, you had the class this morning, osteoconductive, osteoproductive, and osteoinductive materials. Here you see some test experiments. I can probably pass over this quickly because of the lecture that was given this morning. So biosilicate, this special material, has been shown to be highly active in clinical trials. And there are some relevant publications recently come out from Zanotto's and Peitel's research effort. In the area of high fast ion conductors, we're working actively with Ana Candida Rodriguez together in understanding all the structural aspects of the ceramization of this special material. You can make it from a glass by crystallizing. It has this famous Nasicon structures, and the ions are moving extremely fast in them. And these are used as separator membranes in the lithium air battery, which is right now the grail, holy grail of the effort in electromobility. The goal really is to use these lithium air batteries to drive the cars, and not just over 100 kilometers, but over hundreds of kilometers. And there's already a lot of experimental results on this. NMR is also useful here to characterize the ceramization process. We see that, unlike in homogeneously nucleating systems, we have a large structural difference between the superionic conducting ceramic, the crystal that sustains the mobility of the lithiums, and the precursor glass, which is actually not very ion conductive. But important is, the crystals are not good for applications. We need the synergy of the glassy matrix with its good interfacing capabilities and the high ion conduction of the crystalline phase. And so we've been following with electrical conductivity measurements and accompanied by NMR, where you can measure the mobility of the lithium ions, the optimum conditions on, you know, what degree of crystallinity do you need in order to get a functioning ceramic that has all the favorable properties and combines them. And one interesting thing to see here, this is glass with this particular composition annealed near the glass transition temperature at different for different times, that it's not a gradual process, but a rather abrupt process in which the electrical conductivities dramatically increase and the activation energy of conducting dramatically drops. So up to here, up to about 64 hours at TG, you have a good ceramic that has application potential. NMR tells, from NMR we learn at this moment that only 10% of the material is crystalline, not more than that. That is theoretically very interesting, because it suggests the some sort of a percolation phenomenon that allows fast ion conduction within a network of ceramic clusters that join together and form an ion conductive path. So we are continuing our investigation in this direction. But in the long run, in the medium term, we're going away from lithium. It's an issue of sustainability. Sodium is much more abundant and has in many ways the same properties, high ion conductivities as lithium. So in terms of price, in terms of availability, I think the future in fast ion conduction lies in the sodium species. You pay a price, of course. You have a lower power power density. You have a lower energy density because you have a higher mass. But it turns out that in the lithium-ion battery field, the performance is anyway limited by the cathode and the available materials in cathode materials working for, with lithium, so that paying the price by going to sodium actually may not be so bad. In the optics field, goal is to develop laser materials, photonic materials. There's highlights here, work from Marcelo Nalins already in collaboration with our EPR group in São Carlos. Here we see an interesting optical results from on lead germinate antimony phosphate glasses that were doped with manganese. Upon heat treatment, this manganese 2 goes to manganese 3, leading to the appearance of this particular new luminescent signal here. And this was actually nailed down on a structural basis by the EPR work, what is happening here to the valences of the manganese. There's also phase separation observed here, crystallization of crystalline phases. Nanoparticles, there has been already a lot of discussion at this meeting on the area of optical properties of silver nanoparticles. This work is also ongoing in at CeRTEV, the creation of silver nanoparticles and their use for in optical applications. Glasses, fluorophosphate glasses, are an active area of research which many of us in here are joining together in. It's not, I mentioned this briefly in my lecture, we're trying to combine the good mechanical properties of phosphate glasses with the good optical properties of fluoride glasses. And it's not just a compromise, but it is a, we hope for synergy there, because the optical properties are mostly controlled by the local coordination of the emitter, the rare earth ion emitters. And if those are dominated by fluoride ions, we can get both of the best of both possible worlds here and get higher efficient, develop lasers with higher efficiencies based on fluoride phosphide matrices. Oops. Yeah, this also, of course, needs, again, detailed structural characterization. And the key question is, what are the rare earth ions doing? Where are they? What are their local environments? And with magnetic resonance, it's a little bit tricky, at least with NMR spectroscopy, to get at this information, because the luminescent ions are paramagnetic, and that sabotages NMR structural characterization. But one can get around this with a threefold strategy, studying diamagnetic mimics, studying the effect of the paramagnetics on nuclei in the matrix that are nearby, and by using a new EPR approach in analyzing electron nuclear dipolar coupling using this technique of electron spin echo envelope modulation, a pulsed EPR technique, that is a, actually a unique availability here at IFISCI in São Carlos, at our CeRTEV in the laboratory of Magon and Donoso. We have this pulsed EPR instrument available. It's the only one south of the equator that we know to exist. And here are some results. I think I can skip this because I'd shown that in my lecture. Let's go on to other systems that are very important in the as optical materials, not so much for lasers, but for optical sensors and other photonic devices based on inorganic, organic hybrid materials. Hybrid materials in the sense that you have an inorganic matrix and organic, organometallic, or inorganic complexes with organic ligands as the emitters. You benefit from the so-called antenna effect, where you basically use the pi electron systems of the organic ligands to enhance the luminescence of the rare earth ions that are complex too. Here you see the rare earth ions in the middle. It's not only rare earth, there's also iridium, an important emissive metal, and copper, platinum, europium, of course, and the organic dyes are the ligands. So these hybrid systems are developed in the laboratory of Andrea de Camargo, who is also doing the complete optical characterization of these materials. Here are some examples. Aluminosilicate matrices that in which you can replace the cations by ion exchange with the sodium cations by ion exchange by cationic dyes, such as rhodamine or this iridium complex here. Covalent binding of complexes to a mesoporous matrix is one approach. Using dipole forces in the self-assembly of mesoporous matrices that have already the dye embedded in them, and van der Waals interactions using this maybe the simplest approach of wet impregnation techniques to immobilize the dyes within the matrix. And finally, the last area that is an area that is actually new to all of us. It concerns catalytic materials. And it's an important subject for the economy of Brazil, where there's a lot of biomass available from the sugar cane, from the coconut shells, and many, many other agrarian byproducts. And to put, Brazil has, of course, this this tradition of putting this to good use in the bioethanol business, where they use conversion of sugar into bioethanol. But all this biomass, all these bio waste that is produced in the sugarcane business also can be converted into useful chemicals or into fuels. And that process is promoted by special catalysts, typically mesoporous materials. But we have always a basic problem with mesoporous materials in the sense that because the materials that need to be converted are macromolecules, there's a mass transport problem. How do these polymeric substances approach and get into these mesoporous materials? And ceramics have a very good property in this regard. They can be, with the help of porogenic agents, can be converted into macroporous systems. So we look for developing ceramic materials that combine the macroporosity with the mesoporosity. Mesoporosity is important for the catalysis. The macroporosity is important for getting the polymeric substances close to the catalytic center. So this is an effort in which several of us are involved, and it's new, and we hope to develop really this very highly application relevant field within our CeRTEV. Some initial results already from Bellini's laboratory that show the functioning of the porogenic agents that were used there. Yeah, and with this, I'd like to finish. This is the entire team, thank you very much for your interest, and I look forward to further discussions. At this point, my colleagues are here to help me with regard to specific questions, if there are any. Thank you very much for your attention.